live now, Kurt.
You're live?
Awesome.
Well, good evening. My name is Kurt Wimpe. I'm with Alliant Engineering, and we're engineering consultants for the city of Bunnell. And we're having this meeting here tonight to kind of talk about what's going on in your neighborhood, assuming you're in the neighborhood that you've seen on these posters here, or have some interest in that. And hopefully we'll address all your questions, kind of talk through how we got here, why the project exists, where the funding's coming from, and what the schedule looks like. So with that, I'm just going to go ahead and point to these boards up front that you've already been looking at. My understanding is, working with the city staff, I should say, we've got Michael Baldwin here, the utilities manager, and Fred Griffith, the city engineer, and we're all going to answer questions for you in just a few minutes. So we're just going to do a few words to explain where we're coming from and where we're going, and then we'll open it up to questions and stuff up front, just an open forum. So we understand, or I understand, I wasn't here, you've experienced in the last few years, and maybe a lot longer than that, that there's been flooding issues in your neighborhood, and especially with the hurricanes that we've gotten the last couple of years, which we haven't had in a long time before that. So the city's been working hard to try and figure out what to do with that. Of course, it takes a lot of money to fix those issues. Unfortunately, they asked us to help them apply for a Ready Community Grant through the St. Johns River Water Management District. We did apply for that grant and got selected for a grant to help with construction on this. We came in number one, so you can be proud of that. Your neighborhood's number one in that application. So they realized some of the importance of this project. The project is split into two parts. One is to alleviate the stormwater flooding that you've experienced in the neighborhood, and also to alleviate some of the infiltration and inflow coming from partially the flooding and the groundwater in the area. The sanitary sewer pipes, which a lot of people, if you're not a civil engineer like me, you have no idea where that is or what that is. But when you flush your toilet, it goes somewhere, right? So those pipes in your neighborhood are very old, and there's some leaking of those pipes. So there's a lot of inflow in the ground going into those pipes, and then that goes into the wastewater treatment plant. And then Mike has to figure out how to treat all that water, especially during high rainfalls.
It costs a lot of money.
And it costs a lot of money. So that's the other half of the project, is actually to line those pipes and line those manholes to prevent all of that inflow from coming into the system. So it's kind of a 50-50 split as far as what's being done out there. So all of the sanitary manholes and all the sanitary pipes out there are being lined with cured-in-place pipe. So they actually do that without digging up your streets. It's pretty slick. I'll show you a video in just a second. So they insert the liner into the manhole and run that down the pipe. They cook it and steam it and cure it, and it becomes a hard pipe on the inside of the old pipe. They go in with a robot and go down and drill out your service line so the service flows again, and you have a brand new pipe in the road. So I'll show you that in a second. But apart from that, we're replacing some of the culverts out there. I know some of you have already asked, is my culvert being replaced? Not all the culverts are being replaced. It depended on the grade and the flow that's going through that area and the condition of the culvert. So we're replacing all the pinch points, all the small restrictions. We're taking those out, putting in larger pipes for that, and then lowering the ditches and cleaning out the ditches all the way down. So I'm positive at the end of this, you're going to experience much better flow out there, and hopefully the stormwater's doing what it's supposed to do. As far as the schedule, we just bid out the project and just got bids back, so we're working with the contractor right now. Hopefully, we'll come to an agreement within the next month and possibly be out there under construction towards the holidays. Now, what does that mean for you? Hopefully not a lot. You're going to experience some inconveniences, but there's not a lot of traffic in your neighborhood, and so hopefully you'll be able to get around and get to your... Maybe I said that wrong. Somebody's already given me the look. Hopefully you don't experience too much inconvenience. There will be some. You'll be notified ahead of time. Some of your driveway culverts are getting replaced, so obviously they're going to have to dig up your driveway. And so you'll not be able to pull into your driveway maybe one day, and you'll have to park out on the street somewhere or something like that. But we'll try to make those inconveniences very small. There will be a time when you cannot flush your toilets, but we will give you plenty of notification for that. So somehow you'll have to figure out different arrangements or accommodations. Hopefully it's not. Usually they can do a segment of pipe within about 4 to 6 hours. So it's not, you know, all day and night, not a 24-hour period. But you will experience a time where you can't flush the toilets or run water out of your kitchen and stuff. So all that being said, we have the plans, the construction plans right here in front of you. Fred and myself and Mike are going to stand here with you and answer any questions you have in just a moment. You can look at your home on the plans and find out if your culvert's being replaced or ask any other questions like that. As far as the overall schedule, we're hoping about a 4 to 5 month total schedule. And more than likely, you will only experience construction in front of your home, on your driveway, or your pipes a few days out of that entire time. So you won't be experiencing a driveway that's unusable for 5 months. It'll be just a few days. With that, I'll open it up for just quick general questions before we actually open it up for open discussion. Does anybody have any specific questions that you're curious about that I didn't answer already? Oh, sure. Yeah, come on up, Mike.
Hello, everyone. Mike Baldwin, Utilities Manager. As Kurt mentioned, when we're entering an area that's going to affect your ability to flush the toilets, we're going to be passing out notices, and that will be traveled along as the project continues. Another thing is when they're working on the swells and the culverts, we're going to try to make sure the contractor works on only one half of the road so that we're not going to be making any kind of dead ends on Deen Road. We're going to keep traffic flowing as much as we can, but that is not the widest of roads, so there may be a flagman out there on the road one day or two, and just be careful, be courteous to the workers. What else we got?
I think that's mostly it. That's it in a nutshell. I want to show this video if I can real quick.
Okay.
I forgot about that while you're standing there. Sound on this is a 1 minute video, so it's very quick. Yeah, it's a 1 minute video. This just gives you a little bit of an understanding of what they're doing
as far
as lining pipes.
Cured in place pipe technology, or
the truck's going to show up like this, since actually I think this company
pipe installed
and
without
them
digging
put stuff out over a manhole just
resin
like that.
Saturated coated felt tubing is inverted
resin
or pulled
in
into
liner,
the existing pipe.
And they put that
hot
in
water
there,
or
they
steam
blow it
is then
there,
circulated throughout the tubing, curing the resin and forming a tight-fitting, jointless,
so
corrosion-resistant pipe
and
within
that
a pipe.
To an actual
service
hardened,
laterals are then restored
pipe.
Using a robotically controlled cutting
robot.
Device.
They've got a camera on there so they can see where it is and they know
finally,
where your service line is.
The rehabilitated pipe is fully inspected by closed-circuit TV.
Pull it back through, double check everything.
In situ forms, trenchless technology is the world's most trusted pipe rehabilitation solution.
There's a lot more to it than that, actually, but that's a simplified version of what they're doing. So when you see a truck out there and you see something over a manhole, that's actually what they're doing.
What's the life expectancy?
It's like any other pipe, it's like 50 years. Yeah, 50, 60 years.
Does that go into the service line?
Just the main. Yeah. That we could do that. Usually the city will only do it out to the right-of-way line. There's actually private companies you can call for your own service line. They'll come to your house and they'll actually dig out right outside your house and make a hole there, get to your pipe, and they'll line out to the right-of-way. So they'll give you a brand new service pipe on your property. Yeah, yeah.
We did bid that item.
Just for this neighborhood to do that just in the right-of-way, actually it wasn't even full right-of-way, just for about 3 feet outside the pipe was another $180,000. Yep. This is at home. Fred Griffith's gonna explain a little bit more.
When you have a sewer line collapse that's 8 to 10 feet deep, it's a massive hole and it's a massive inconvenience to the public. So the important thing is to keep the mains clear and open and not collapsing. So that's the number one priority. You know, we'd love to be able to line the laterals, but if you think about it, if we have one lateral collapse, guess what? We just got to open it up. We just got to, you know, it's a lot easier fix, okay? But if we had millions of dollars, I'd love to line the laterals and the mains. I could do the whole city. We're doing this project. We're doing the South Side project here shortly on the other side of US 1. And it's going to do a lot to save us, okay? I mean, right now we've got, when we have rainfall, it's tripling our flow coming into our wastewater treatment plant. That means that we're way over capacity of the plant, and you have to pump and treat all that water, okay? And it's extensive cost, added cost to the city, so this should help us a lot, as well as providing an opportunity to prevent, hopefully, future collapses of our sewer system and disruption to our roads.
Excuse me? Just one, and typically you won't get full collapses. You know, it'll crumble and break up over time. You start getting root intrusion into the pipe and so forth. And a traditional dig and replace method, your streets would be dug up for, you know, a couple months in front of your house. It's a real big mess. It takes a lot of time and energy, and it's just awful. So this lining is so much better in residential areas. I think that's old clay pipe. Yep. Yep.
We haven't been able to get the camera in their old way to see if the pipe is separated or not, but we've been having to clean it routinely. We do have some sand build up down the line, so that section of pipe is going to get done on this project. Yeah, that line is around 10 feet deep at the bottom of the swell, so you add another 2 feet there, you're 12 feet deep on the side of the road that you don't want to cave in. So it's beyond our crew's capabilities to fix it. To sub that out, the cost is just multiplying. Within this project, we'll be able to take care of it while the crews are on site.
I would say Mike's probably your best contact.
Yeah. I'm listed as project manager, so if anybody needs my number, if they want for a future contact, I can provide that off to somebody.
I can get his home number if you really need it. So the boards you see in front of here above the tables, they have a dashed line with a big number in it. That number represents the sheet of the plan sets. For that area inside the dashed line. So if you want to look and see where your house is at, what's going on, you can reference that and look at the plans below and just turn to the right sheet number. As far as what you're looking at, if you look on the screen here, so this is obviously your road and you can see your driveways. There, above each driveway, you will see an address. So you can pick off your address. And then you can look here on this side of the street. This is a profile. So that's the ditch in side view. Okay, it's called the profile, and that shows the ditch, shows the center of the road. The existing ditch is shown in the dashed line, and then the proposed ditch.
Hi, welcome to Permaliner.
Where it's going to be when we're done with construction is in the solid line.
Founder of Permaliner.
And then it shows your culvert.
Permaliner's been around since.
Shows the size of it, and kind of where that falls in the ditch, so you can get a feel for it. If it's dashed,
widely used,
that means existing.
If
it's solid line, that means that's going to be replaced. So some of them are going to stay the way they are because they work with the system the way we figured out the design was going to work.
Failing sewer lines is.
And the conditions, you know, was okay to not replace it. Some are getting replaced because they're just undersized, or the conditions was bad, or they just didn't meet the grade and we had to lower them anyway. So we went ahead and replaced them. So as you look in the plans, you can kind of see that. And again, Fred and myself and Mike will be up here and we can just answer any questions you have. Any other general questions?
And you also have some
before we
pipes,
close it off to
cement and another
feed.
Type of pipe, which is called Orangeburg. These pipes can all be rehabilitated using our permaliner.
We're gonna work
system,
with the contractor to decide exactly how to do that.
Product,
I know there's traffic that goes through there.
Now, to start, what you're going to do
it
is
feels
you're
like
go
the
in,
way
you're
to go. We might put road construction ahead and have some flaggers. If it feels better,
if the pipe's totally collapsed,
we might close it off only to local traffic.
Solution such as dig and replace,
and then we'll just have to see
our system is designed to go in where the pipe is defective. With you know, maybe it has infiltration, root infiltration, water infiltration. There's pipe pieces of pipe missing. There could be the whole pipe missing. As long as we have a pilot hole, we can actually realign the pipe and create
you're
pipe
actually you're
the pipe.
You're
so
east of the project.
Place,
so the project
cured,
starts after Tolman.
The existing pipe
is that right?
Not, does not so, make up the structural properties of our new liner.
So
liner
I don't think you're going to have any access issues to that industrial park.
And it is actually certified by NSF.
Yeah, they'll just have to come from the east.
Codes across the industry.
So if they're coming
so
from the west, they'll have to go over the overpass and come around and come from the east.
The pipe's a candidate. What we're going to use for the actual equipment. And this is called
perfect.
Our PermaCam.
Yeah.
Our PermaCam
shouldn't experience any issues.
To visually inspect the inside of the pipe.
Anybody else?
And once
all right, we're
going to
open it up. We're
going to
close
pipe,
off the live stream and open it up for questions
take some
up here.
Measurements. Okay, and this is typically done.
Apparently, we're not going to close off the
now,
live stream.
A lot of people don't have.
But nobody will hear what's going on up front, probably because we're going
to
be talking one on one.
Inside the
is that the way? Is that acceptable?
So we have another product, and this product is
we're going to speak loud as loud as we can.
The Vacati simply is a product that uses what you can see. It looks just like a T. Okay, and it goes down.
We're running out of time, so we have
the
planning board meeting at 6 o'clock. So we're trying to wrap up by 6:15.
This can be done by hydro excavation.
So that's part of why we're doing what we're doing right now.
Down if it's shallow enough, typically where the lateral pipe is closer to your home in some areas of the United States and you know, the rest of the world, you can actually gain access just by digging a couple feet. However, this process is simply installed by using our special adhesive material to the Vacati. It's slipped over the existing pipe, and you can see here what it looks like once it's slipped over top. What we do then is we have a core drill bit that goes inside, and it actually core drills out the actual existing pipe inside of this 4-inch, this is a 4-inch T right here, inside this 4-inch T. Once that's done, we can put a standpipe on it, which will bring it up to the ground level, and then we can put a clean-out cap on top of it, and that would be an existing clean-out. Now, this is going to give you your access if you do not have a clean-out. If you have a clean-out, then you can use your existing clean-out. Once that's done, you're going to simply put your inspection camera inside the clean-out, get the video inspection, and then you're also going to take your measurements. And we have a whole certification that comes along with each one of our systems. And for the permalateral system, it's typically a 3 to 4 day training session at your location. We send out our training, and our trainers are all certified permaliner certification trainers. And they come out and they basically certify your crew to install our product. Now, we also have what we call field report sheets. So all the data that you're collecting, such as the weather, the location, the time of day, also the size of the pipe, the diameter of the pipe, any kind of defects inside the pipe can all be put onto this field report sheet. And it's good to have that for your records, as well as making a videotape of the existing pipeline. Once you collect all that data, you're going to have what you need to go and basically start the lining process. Okay? So in order to start the lining process, you're going to need your felt liner, which comes in a 300-foot roll. And that's basically this material right here. And you can see on the material, it's very easy to identify our liner material because we have our name printed on it. We have our patent number on it. This is a patented lining system. And then we also have our certification. Okay, here you can see that we have the ICC, ESPMG. You also can see that we have the NSF Standard 14 as well as the IATMO. So that's very important, especially when you get involved with different plumbing codes and different cities across, you know, any parts of the world. You want to make sure you can show them that you're using a certified product that is plumbing code approved. Now, this liner material, real quick, is made of a PVC material. There's a scrim inside of it, and that's very important because what we call this process is a blind shot process. It's an inversion process, but it's blind shot. So that means we're going from a single access point, and we're going to stop this liner at an exact pinpoint location in the line, and that's typically at the connection point of the sewer main. So So we don't want this liner to overstretch, and that's what that scrim liner does in there. This patented scrim liner that's built into our liner will allow us to stop this liner anywhere in the pipe at the pinpoint location that we need to stop it at. And like I said, we typically, when these liners are done, we want to line the entire lateral, so we're going to stop it right at the main connection. The liner material itself is also made up of a 3 millimeter needle punch felt, and this is what's going to hold the resin. So this is what we call the carrier, okay? Now, to keep that resin uniform thick in the liner, we want to make sure that there's a coating on it, and that's a PVC coating on this liner. It's stitched together, and then it's actually got a heat welded tape seam over top. And so this liner is 100% airtight. It's going to hold the resin, and it's going to allow us to invert, and it's going to be uniform thickness from the time that we start the inversion to the time we stop. Our resin is sold, supplied to you in 5 gallon buckets. There's part A, and then we also have part B, which is the hardener, okay? And it's clearly marked on there what the products are, okay? We also have different temperatures of resin that we use throughout the year to meet your climate changes. We also have a heat assisted equipment such as steam. We'll allow you to go in and reline a pipe in as little as 40 minutes. We also have hot water circulation, where you can go in and again, you can line the pipe much quicker than you can ambiently. And then of course we have the ambient cure system, which will allow you to go in and typically line the pipe in about 3 hours. So as you can see, we have many different support pieces to this system that will allow you to maintain your installation practices in a very timely manner. Typical installation out in the field, plumbers are typically doing this in a couple hours, so you can have some plumbers. I mean, we have record guys. We have guys out there putting liners in at sometimes 3 a day. Sometimes they're putting them in 6 a day. There is some prep work involved, and we also have that equipment as well. Back here, we have what we call a maxi miller. This is a cutter, and it comes with different cutter heads on it, so you can go in and you can prep the pipe, such as a cast iron pipe where you may have a lot of tuberculin buildup inside. You want to be able to clean that pipe and get it back to its, you know, somewhat original diameter before we put the liner in. Because again, this is going to take the shape of whatever's in the pipe to a certain degree if it's undersized. So we have support equipment there, as you can see. Typically, guys will use high-pressure jet units to wash out any debris in the pipe, and they'll use mechanical cutters to cut out roots and other buildup in the pipe, such as cast iron, roots, things like that. Now, once the liner material is impregnated with the two-part resin, okay, we're going to basically load the liner material into this equipment right here. And this is called the permaverter, okay? And this permalateral air inversion unit uses low pressure. We simply load the material into the inversion unit, and then we just basically hook the air supply back here. We have a slight window in the back we can look into. We also have a slight window on top, and this all basically locked down, airtight. And once we have the liner material loaded into the unit, we simply clamp it on the front end here to what we call our inversion head. Okay, and this inversion head, basically the liner is pulled back over top of it, folded back over, and I'll give you a little sample of how it looks. You're basically going to take this liner material and it's going to fold back over that inversion head, so it's going to look sort of like this, okay, and it's going to be inside. Once we start to apply pressure, the liner material, because it's sealed at this inversion head, low pressure is going to start to push itself out on its own. So it's doing what we call an inversion. And when it inverts, it turns itself inside out. So now you have the resin and the felt up against the hose pipe and the coating on the inside. And once that's installed 100% all the way out to the main, what we do is we also hold it in place with what we call a cal tube. And this blue material here is what we call the calibration tube. And it's a large bladder, and it's going to hold that liner in place while it's curing. Once the liner has gone through the cure process, whether it's steam, hot water, or ambient, we're going to simply go in and we're going to re-invert this cal tube back out of the existing pipeline, and then we're ready for the inspection. Now, at any given time, if there's a question whether the cal tube is all the way out, it's been inverted all the way, or the liner's been inverted all the way, we have a patented camera inspection port built into our equipment. And what this does is allow you to push this camera, and if you can look here at the inversion head, you'll kind of see it go through, but you can see that the camera, but This will allow you to push the camera all the way through the inverter head into the liner, and you can push it all the way out to the end of the liner, so you can see that this liner is holding up against the hose pipe, as well as the calibration tube is all the way out, and it's past the end of the liner, so it's acting as a 100% bladder, you know, within the inside of that liner material. Now, this is all airtight. The unit is pressurized during this inspection time, so there's no chances of the liner collapsing and getting any kind of voids behind the liner while it's sitting in place. Once that's done, we can pull this simply back out of the liner, spool it back up onto the reel. We then turn this valve right here, and we can disconnect this camera inspection point, and then we can start our curing process. Once the curing process is done, again, we're going to remove the cow tube, and we're ready for final inspection. And we're going to put the same camera back in the pipe, and we're going to inspect it. And it's going to look pretty much like what's inside this pipe right here. Okay, this is a finished product. And what we've done is we've simulated underground broken pipe by using this PVC. Okay, you can see we have some holes in it to show you some damaged pipe here. And you can see how the resin migrates out through the openings. And that's basically sealing it up. You can also see that it's a pretty airtight fit around the existing pipe. And you can see here the same for the cast iron pipe on this opposite side. And you can see how it's airtight around the seam, okay, between the hose pipe and the new material. And you can see also the quality of the install. It's 100% up against the existing pipe, okay? So it does have the ability to stretch a little bit, so it can meet the circumference of either a cast iron, an Orangeburg, a clay pipe, a PVC pipe, or whatever pipe may be in the ground, okay? Now, once this is inspected, you can immediately put your lateral back into service. There's no downtime. The only downtime you have is during the installation, and that's fairly quickly, especially if you're using a steam cure process. Again, you can do it in about 40 minutes. There's really no cleanup. If you're using our patented lateral access, because you can line through a lateral, okay? So you can eliminate the need for big, you know, large pit areas. And what we have here is technology that's patented, and this is basically a spoon that goes down inside of a lateral, and it allows to direct the liner around the bottom of the T. Okay, so this would be your T here. This is 4-inch. That spoon is designed for 6-inch, but you get the idea that we also make spoons for this 4-inch as well. But the spoon would be pushed down in here. It would direct the liner at this point to go in the direction of down, you know, the direction of you want to shoot the liner, which is typically downstream towards the main. So that will direct that liner, and this way you would need to excavate down and open up the pipe. Now, you can also shoot this from a basement. You can, if you had an open pit for some reason, you wanted to shoot from open pit, you could do that as well. But typically, for the ease of installation, a lot of our installers, and we have quite a few in North America, they're typically using a clean out process with a spoon to direct the liner, and they're using the steam cure process. And again, it's as little as 40 minutes that you can be on site and finished with the lateral lining process.
Right now, Doug is pre-mixing our B-side resin. This is our catalyst and hardener. Pre-mixing it because the catalyst is actually lighter than the hardener, so it tends to float towards the top. So what he wants to do is get a thorough mix. Cole, the other guy to the left, he is pouring the A-side resin. It's a 2-to-1 ratio. This being a short 10-foot shot, I believe it was 6 pounds of A, 3 pounds of the B. Now what he's doing is pouring in 3 pounds of the B side resin. Since we're down here in Florida, it's about 85 degrees ambient temperature, so we're using a hot weather blend. At this point, you're going to mix the two resins together. This is a 100% solid epoxy resin. Gives a 0% shrinkage. When you're done, you know by the milky consistency that you have a full mix. What you're doing now is you're resealing the liner so all the resin is now inside the liner, the total of 9 pounds.
Okay, cool.
What he's doing is calibrating his roll, his pitch roller, to evenly distribute the resin. Right now you can see the saturation of the liner, and the vacuum is pulling the resin into the felt material.
This is a 3 foot line curl. Stick it up my hand.
Okay.
Get the visual.
Okay. It's a much quicker process with the vacuum.
That's good.
Usually only one pass is needed. I'm saturating out the liner. We're ready to pull. Is going to remove the vacuum head to the inversion head from the inversion head. And what he's done now is he's removed the tape, which is now going to be the far end. That will be the end out towards the main. He's going to use one rubber band to give yourself back pressure when inverting the liner. And the second rubber band is used to put the pull strap, the blue strap knot, and that will help guide it into the inverter. At this point, they're winding the lining material into the inverter. RJ is going to oil up the liner. This is going to reduce any friction, helping the liner to invert on itself.
Okay.
So he's oiling up the liner. It's going to reduce any type of friction.
Yep.
And he's going to lubricate up the head real well.
That's fine.
Because all the liner has to pass through this one single point, so you make sure you get a good oil. At this point, they're attaching or just taping a guide delivery hose. This is cut specifically for 3 feet 4 inches of material. This way, that's the point in which they wet the liner out to. Okay, he's introducing this into the pipe. And the male's gonna take this, and you're all the way out. Now what you have is an open end on the other side. So what we're gonna do is load our calibration tube, which is our bladder, which holds the liner up against the hose pipe. We're gonna cut the guide tube right now. And he's going to attach. He's cutting a 4-inch slit in the liner material. Cole is now attaching the pull strap to the calibration tube. pull strap is what's used to pull the calibration tube back out from the pipe after the 3-hour ambient cure. Doug's going to put a final tape around the knots to ensure a good seal. Now, once again, RJ is going to lubricate up the calibration tube to allow for easier inversion. Doug is just winding it up into the inverter. Then Cole is going to cam lock the inversion head to the nozzle. Cole's going to fasten, just using duct tape, fasten the liner to the front of the inversion head, that way the calibration tube has a path to follow. Starts releasing the calibration tube at approximately 8 to 10 psi. Now, if there is infiltration in the pipe, groundwater coming in, this is going to squeegee and push out any of that groundwater out the cracks and then all the way to the main. Now, the calibration tube is cut 2 feet longer than the liner. That way you're going to have a nice open pipe at the end. Okay, at this point, Cole is going to use the pinch clamp. This way you're keeping positive pressure on your lateral line. Because if you were to lose pressure in your lateral, infiltration could come in creating a pocket. So you can clamp it off, and Doug is going to release all the pressure in the tank, the air in the tank. Okay, now Cole is removing the cam lock and the pull strap. Cut